Look, this one's going to be a little different. If you notice, I have less than 1,000 subscribers, which means I cannot monetize or make any money from any of the content that I put out on YouTube. And I just want to point it out because of who this video is for. I haven't taken a cent. I started making videos about some of the spiritually repressive things that were going on in my life, and I really didn't expect anybody to believe me. But as I started to make friends or get to know people, I continued. And I've dealt with that since 2016, since before I really started making videos. And it's a funny thing that when you have like a spiritual PTSD, I've tried to explain it to people before and I don't think they really grasp it. It's like a post-traumatic stress disorder of a spiritual nature. The church is not equipped to handle it. They have no idea what they're doing when it comes to things of the demonic. Usually when I reached out, it was the first thing that I did, right? You go to a church and they're just like, don't worry about it, Jesus paid for it all, you're good. I'm like, you don't understand, like this is going on, you know. Anyway, this video is actually from my dad. It's in the public domain because, as I've mentioned before in some of the other videos, I've noticed that once you put something out, I don't know if it's on like to the ether, like once it's on the internet, or once you say it out loud in the world, those that are in the know, the royal they, seem to behave differently, almost as if they've received the information. And I've tested it several times, and every time the world responded after I talked about a topic on something. Like in my own personal life, whether I was walking through the park or it's just things stuck out to me. So, you really don't have to stick around if you're not my dad. I'm just putting it out there because I wanted one or two witnesses. So, I mean, all I need is one or two of you. I don't hate you. I have a level of distrust for a good reason. And I may have been felt pressed to make this video because your wife has reached out several times. She's a nice lady. I appreciate that. I doubt that she would even know that any of this went on or why I'm given such a cold shoulder. But I can't in my mind get past the things that happened to me back in 2016. Not just from you. There's a lot of people, and we're gonna go over some of that. And it's made me disassociate from relationships with people. I don't trust another human being alive. That's very different than distrust, which I have for, you know, some of you. You know, I thought about just complaining about all this stuff that happened in my childhood. And I mean, the house was a little cold. You provided excellently. We went to Disney World, what, like 5 times? But I don't see the point. I've struggled with wanting to tell your ex-wife I hope that her death is as lonely as my life has been, because she ruined any value of me and women's eyes as a whole, the way that she treated me in my childhood. And I know that she had it rough from a stepmother, so she should have known better. But instead of telling her that, I just sent her a picture of my brother dancing with her on his wedding day. And the truth is, no one really cared. Like, the world doesn't care. You're a man, like, nobody cares what happened to you. But it just, I was beaten down from the beginning, and didn't really have any direction in life, and the frustration of not having guidance. That's another big one. Young men get so violent when they don't have a a male, you know, guiding them into manhood. And I hope to break this cycle. I think I'm doing my best to raise Aiden as a strong young man. He understands. I have not sugarcoated anything. He understands what drugs are, what they do to people, the way that they ruin lives. He understands what pornography is and the way that it ruins lives, and what girls on OnlyFans actually think about their clients, because they don't actually talk to real women. They just pay for a girlfriend experience. So I guess growing up in that environment and not really feeling like I fit in school or even in my own house, it sort of set the stage for me to seek a path of escapism, that avenue being drugs and alcohol when I was older. He let me go to my uncle's house, who had just gotten out of prison for selling drugs when I was 13, 14, 15. I don't think it matters. Whatever. I was 15 or 13. And I really didn't do anything but hang out at the house the entire summer. It was pretty lonely. We barely did much. He was just off doing his thing. But he, for some reason, decided to take me to my very first meth deal when I was whatever age that was. And the impact that that has on a young, developing mind is it's pretty strong. You ever seen those videos? There's a video of this kid came out a couple of years ago. He's either Vietnamese or Taiwanese, or he's Asian. He's like 8 years old and he's smoking cigarettes. He might be from the Philippines. It's somewhere where cigarettes are like just commonplace. And he's smoking cigarettes, and when he runs out, he throws these temper tantrums because he doesn't have it. And that's because his brain's still developing. He is an addict and doesn't. Anyway, you get the point. And please don't retaliate against your brother. He's an ass for doing that. And the fact that the house that we went to, I know that those men were abusing runaways because they had a room set up in the back for them. They didn't do anything to me. He didn't leave me alone with them, but I mean, they did want to pass me a meth pipe, right? And instead of protecting vulnerable kids, I guess Uncle thought the dope was more important. Back then, we were barely into the internet on dial-up. I mean, AOL was still a popular thing, and there were no, like, faces of meth. There were the information out there about it rotting out your teeth and ruining your skin, and people stealing copper out of houses, just all that. None of that was there, so you didn't know. And you're just like, this is great. This is a wonderful feeling, you know? And I only tell you that story because maybe that was the opening door, but like I said, don't retaliate against him, because I probably would have sought escapism anyway, given just feeling inadequate. I still have pretty low self-esteem, to be honest with you, when it comes to speaking with women. With men, I have no problem handling an altercation at all, but there's I don't know, just level of insecurity somewhere. And it took me years to figure out that taking drugs and alcohol was just my way of going, I don't want to deal with that right now, I just want to feel good. But I mention all this to really lay the groundwork to say, I mean, I don't want to say I'm an expert in what drugs should do to you, your behavior, the culture, but I know a lot about it. I'm 37 years old, Dad, and if I started on one of the worst ones when I was 15, not a heavy user, but I know what they should have done. So fast forward, right? I go through all these different things, and drugs are just commonplace. Move out at a very, very early age, and obviously I was with a lot of other young men who didn't really have any guidance or direction, or their parents just didn't care. And so they were, you know, just getting into trouble and partying. I never really had a reason not to do those things. But then I reached a point when I turned 30, and I don't even remember where the thought came from, but I started blaming God for everything that was wrong with my life. And I just remember being, maybe I was just mad at religion or people, I don't know. But I thought it was God's fault. I did. I legitimately did. And I don't remember who the first person asked me, but you, my mother, several friends, these are all on separate occasions, on like a week period, asked me, well, what about God or what about Jesus or some form of that question? What do you think about that? You know? And I said, bold as a lion. Funny, you really can't fight against your nature even when you're actively working against it. And very shortly after that, it was almost like in the spirit world, those questions being asked and given my response, there was a green light from all sorts of demonic stuff to start happening to me. And from that point on, any time that I would consume a drug, being a full intravenous drug addict, chaos would ensue. You know, like when you're, I don't know, the shadow people, stuff like that, like it was never a problem before. It was just kind of like, whatever, I'm hallucinating. And then they started moving things in the house and I could feel this dark presence, and even the dog started, he was like, no, something's wrong. Like he was afraid. And I could always tell that something wasn't right, that I was like one step closer to hell. Really fearful, but that thirst for escapism continued. So that's why I had the experience so much. And, you know, I was going to go into a long spiel about the music. I'm not going to. Listen, I've analyzed a lot of bands, Breaking Benjamin, Architects, Highly Suspect. What's the other one? Fall Out Boy. Their lyrics are very specific. Songs of War. Breaking Benjamin is probably the easiest one because they openly sing about praying to fallen angels. I mean, they're literally, you know, talking about war with heaven. So I guess it's war with us by proxy. And I've analyzed that stuff. I was going to go into a long spiel about it, but the point is that I see a world where there are people who are actively engaging in war with God in secret, and they don't share information with people like me. But they can talk about it poetically in their music. So the year I turned 30, every time I took a substance, all this demonic stuff started happening. And even when I wasn't on anything, some very strange things happened. And I guess it was like as if the demonic world was like, well, God in Christ is the last person that he's going to call on, right? Because of my response when people asked me about him. But the trouble was, it was some of those experiences were around all of you that asked me about God in Christ. And going even further into it, strange occurrences. For instance, Jesse Timms, he was my best man in my wedding. Always trying to get me to do dope. You know, after me and Erica split up and I was working, not for him, but underneath him. And one particular time, he gave me some drugs. I knew something was wrong immediately, and I was like, I just want to go home, just want to go home. Very fearful. We arrived to a McDonald's, and he was just stalling. And at that point, I had called you. And I was just telling him, you can leave. Like, it's fine. My dad's coming to get me. And he wouldn't, and he started asking me about what was in my pockets or that I would get in trouble, and I was like, I don't have any drugs on me. And he's like, you don't have anything. I said, and at the time, again, heroin addict, right? So I had a prescription for Suboxone. I had one Suboxone strip in my pocket. And I'm like, no, I just have a Suboxone on me, and that's it. I don't have anything incriminating on me. And he looks over. He's sitting in his truck. There's no one else in it because I was riding shotgun, but I'm out the car trying to tell him you can leave. So he turns from talking to me and looks over at thin air. This is going to be reoccurring. And says, do you want a Suboxone? And I look at him and he smiles. And like clockwork, he pulls off right before you pulled up. And of course, you know, you were angry and kind of yelling at me. That doesn't seem very demonic. That seems like there's a human element. You know, I could speculate all day. Like, maybe y'all already have the neural link and you can talk. But, and I've struggled to explain this to, you know, people at church or people of faith. And the best way that I can explain it is the way that we see on a spectrum. You know, you have X-ray on one end, gamma ray on the other end. We can't see them. We need machines to do that. And it's a similar thing like that. You, the royal you, not just you, Dad, have access to information that we don't. And I don't know how that is. I do know that there's an uptick whenever someone consumes drugs and they see it, right? Makes me less credible. But I've had so many experiences with that. It literally took all of that for me to stop wanting to take any of that stuff because I knew something was wrong. You stood in a trailer with me alone. There was no other person in the house, just the dog, my dog. And after you threw him in a kennel, you stood chest to chest with me in a thin trailer hallway, pointed to my room and said, get in there and get it done now, because I'm the only one that pays the light bill. And I knew that there was something there. I mean, I'm shortening all this because I don't want this video to be 3 hours long. I could tell there was a dark presence in the room. And you were trying to hide the fact that you were communicating with it. But the dog was looking at it too. And every time when it would shift and move, not only would your neck turn, but the dog's would too. Anyway, after you said that, my response, like anyone I've ever told the story to, was, get what done? More fearful, probably, you know. But you smiled. You smiled like you were well pleased with whatever you thought was about to happen. And then you walked off. And something, I mean, I can only describe it as the Holy Spirit. But just this little voice, you know, just knowing, said, grab that dog out the kennel and walk outside. And that's what I did. And you were pissed. And then left the house. I made a video in the midst of me, you know, starting this. The only thing I knew what to do. You do realize that, like, I had such trauma that whenever I finally moved in with my Aunt Dana, what was that, 2017, beginning of 2018, I would not leave unless it was to go to church or with family, anywhere. Would not leave the house. And I made a video, it's like 2017, 2018, about me bumping into this girl in 2016, Mardi Gras, 2016, it was a Saturday. I'm walking down Bourbon Street. Uncle Troy was, you know, he's got a condo at the other end of it. And something felt like it was, nothing, I didn't hear anything audibly, but I was just like, something's watching you, or someone, you know. So I'm expecting to make eye contact, to turn around. There's thousands of people in the street. It's, you know. shoulder to shoulder, and I didn't notice anything. And when I turned back around, me and this chick connected. I can send you the video if you want, but you know, so months and months and months go by, and when we were sitting in this, God just kept reminding me, Madeline. And the only thing that I heard, you know, after I bumped into her, some guy grabbed her shoulder and was like, Madeline, come on. And then she was out of my sight. She's super pretty, super pretty. And so anyway, so I tell this story of this thing going on, or this thing that happened. 2016 is when it actually happened on Bourbon Street without camera footage. 2018 is whenever I told the story on a YouTube channel, probably around, you know, with 500 viewers. And then I moved out in 2019. And I had this this angry, you know, bull dyke lesbian landlord. And she was going to Walmart one day. And I said, can I ride with you? I'd like to get a daiquiri from the daiquiri shop right next to it. So there was this chick that worked there that looked almost exactly like her. So much that the first time I saw her, I thought that it was her. And I had to go back to verify, and I figured out that it wasn't her. And I forgot about it. But when I pulled up with Margaret Blackwell driving me, who I had only met in 2019, and told a story in 2018 about something that happened to me in 2016 that she shouldn't have known about because she didn't watch my minuscule YouTube channel. The girl opens the window, asks for the order, I give it, and then Margaret looks at her and goes, oh, is that her? Ooh. And I knew exactly what she meant, and she wouldn't speak for the rest of the ride home. She looked terrified, really, that she had just revealed something. So I ask you, Dad, how does someone that I met in 2019 know about a person that I bumped into in 2016? I know the woman was evil, but how do people have access to information like that? Hidden knowledge, because it's not that they watched the video. I was of no interest to that person in 2016, nor could they probably pick me out of the thousands, if not, you know, million people that walked through Bourbon Street that day. I had another experience with two police. This happened with police on several occasions, but one in particular, it was after they had already made the law of them wearing the body camera footage, you know, like they had to wear a body cam, it's always active. And the guy's talking with me, you know, they were concerned about something demonic was going on. It was after I had taken a drug, and the guy's talking with me on the corner, but you know, I had a pocket knife, can of mace, something, you know. And after he had taken it away, he and his partner are sitting there talking. They had cuffed me. You know, I'm not ever aggressive towards police or anything. I'm not going to make it worse on myself. But the interesting thing was, after he let me out of the cuffs, he's talking with his partner. So if I'm right here, his partner's over here. And they're talking, and I don't remember where it led to, but he looks at, again, thin air, and he goes, do you have his knife? He said, do y'all have his knife and his mace? I can't hear anything. I can't see anyone that's there, but I know that it happened, and I know that it's on the body camera footage. There was another time with two Tangipahoa Parish Sheriff's Department officers that, something similar happened. I'm not going to go into the whole thing, but I can tell you this. They showed up at Lane and Chancey's wedding. My cousin and his now wife. Off duty, as if they knew him. And I asked him I asked Lane. I was like, hey, you know those two? You know, because of this horrible night. And he said, yeah. I said, they're cops, right? He said, yeah. So they work for Tangipahoa Parish? And he said, no, I think they work for Livingston. But they were at his wedding. They knew him. Lane's wife has made comments and things that there's no way that she should know about me. I mean, very, very personal things that any person, or especially husband, would question how someone has access to that information if they didn't know. And the interesting thing was, whenever she revealed it, my sweet Aunt Dana, my mom's twin sister, looked at her and goes, you don't know that. You see the gaslighting going on over and over and over and over through these experiences. And, you know, dude, I don't know what it is. But again, that spectrum, there's a world that whatever I am, my kind doesn't see. And that you people are different and you treat us differently. And I guess you're sworn to secrecy because when you reveal stuff, you get real nervous. I started telling the stories on YouTube because it was like a therapy thing for me. I didn't know what else to do. I don't know how much you know about PTSD. I mean, I don't know much about it from like a soldier standpoint that was in Iraq and went through something, but I can tell you, I'm pretty sure that if it's anything like what I've experienced, you relive all of those moments every day. So there's so many that I'm leaving out just for the sake of time. But you think about it every day, every single day, every day. And you try and either rationalize it or get a better understanding. But it's really hard whenever it's of a spiritual nature. It's not just physical. As a matter of fact, in every one of these instances, besides Margaret revealing that she knew what the girl looked like, every one of you had to take a back seat to what you expected to happen. It's almost as if you behave like slaves to whatever that thing is. Well, this story with Jesse and the Suboxone thing, that's not extremely demonic, but he was talking to something. He was talking to something. So I spent a few years carrying this burden just over and over and over every day, thinking about all these situations, trying to figure it out. And around the time all that started to happen, I guess I forgot to mention this part. In 2016, I forgot to mention everything. It clicked. I lost all my anger. Forgot I didn't blame God anymore. I realized that if all this demonic stuff was happening, then the story, all of it, must be real. It's real. And if they're real, then that means he's real too. Thank God for mercy, man, because I was extremely rude. Extremely rude to my creator. And just shortly after that, I hadn't moved out of the trailer yet. I stumbled upon a man named Rob Skiba, who made a profound... I watched... He's got four presentations. He's got more, but these four presentations that he did about Babylon and... the Fallen Watchers, I watched them over and over and over and over. And read the Book of Enoch over and over. Joshua, Jubilees, all these extra biblical texts. And around that same time, a man named Neil Gaiman came out with a book called American Gods. It's about all the pagan deities. And it really transformed my thought process about these things. Because he characterized the old Norse gods. He actually made characters out of them, personality types, based on the writings of them. And that planted the seed in me. It's a pretty worldly show, and Hollywood makes everything gay. They can't help but to throw their agenda into anything that they make. But I started working on a story based on the Apocrypha. And at the very beginning, it starts out basically at the Tower of Babel. It's a story of Joshua, dramatized. Some of the supporting role characters, I decided to use some of the grimoires, or like from the Testament of Solomon, Asmodeus. He's a demon. But the good guys are characters based on the book The Witness of the Stars. Fascinating. The stars actually tell the story of creation. And it's based on their names, like what they actually, their names mean. It's fascinating stuff. So instead of like the star Arcturus, it would be a guy named like Archie Taurus, right? And when other people's decisions and sin, selfishness, leads to someone like him dying, you see a star fall. But the bulk of the story, the actual story with the main protagonist, is set in modern times, where you have this guy that really doesn't fit in. He doesn't really understand his purpose in life, can't really find a really good job to work at, or, you know, a girlfriend or anything like that. He's just like, he's like lost, but he's a good guy. And these characters start taking interest in him, these very powerful characters, and they try to corrupt him, but they can't. They know what he is, but he doesn't. And he doesn't even realize that he's hanging out with the fallen watchers of the Book of Enoch. Semyaza, the leader, the alpha male type, womanizer, loves the party. Azazel, chaos, expert in war and all things violent. Really never actually lies, but he knows how to provoke people because he's a watcher, so you can't violate, you can't just go around beating up people, or, you know, archangels will show up. But he knows how to manipulate people into swinging on him. So, you know, you have to choose it, right? Gadriel, the serpent from the garden, plays the zealous Christian. Not a Christian at all. But how else would you tear people away from Christ after the new covenant than to pretend to misrepresent what you or claiming to be, and to do it in such a way that it turns people away from him, from ever seeking him? So all these things are based in logic. And anyway, so there's all these different characters. There's way more characters than that. Ezekiel is the one that taught the signs of the clouds. He's a weatherman, but they're leading people to their death. They're leading people astray into their own selfishness and sin. The wages of sin is death. And they die, and that's how they stay young. It's very vampiric in nature, but they're not like actual vampires. And Azazel decides to move them from California, from the City of Angels, to New Orleans. Why New Orleans? Because it is the only place in America. I mean, yeah, they have little parades in Mississippi, but it's the only place where we are known for a celebration of drunken debauchery, where we march every pagan god through the streets of New Orleans. And we have the nerve to call it a Christian festival. There's a scholar named Michael Heiser that wrote a book called The Unseen Realm. And he gives a case for God having a divine council, but one of the things that stuck out to me, and you could read it in the English, you know, but God, Yahuwah, and the other Elohim, we're walking around the Tower of Babel. That always stuck with me, and they like, people didn't notice them, and they were like, look at what they've done, you know. And so I'm just curious to know. I believe that the Elohim walk among us. Matter of fact, this is a sidebar, but I was dating a girl. She flew in to see me. Had never been to New Orleans. She wasn't here to party, Christian woman. But I said, do you want to go see Bourbon Street? You know, I mean, you're here, taking the smells. And we were walking through, and this homeless man, a little dirty, this old black man, gray hair, beard. He was wearing a jacket. It's hot down here. I don't know why. It's black jacket, not quite a trench coat, but almost like denim. And I was like, do you want some food? And she was like, yeah. And so we're going through, I'm trying to find him food. And I asked him if he wanted a pepperoni pizza. And he was like, no. And I started getting frustrated. I don't eat pork. I think it's an unclean thing. And I was getting frustrated with a homeless man because he didn't want something with pork on it. And that never came to me until months later. But the important thing is, so finally I got him fed and everything. He didn't. I was like, do you want me to buy you a beer? You know? He didn't. And so one day I'm walking through downtown Hammond, walking the dogs. And there's this homeless guy walking in the middle of the street. He's almost like skipping. He's so joyful. And I was on the phone or something. I was distracted by something. But I noticed him. And this, he looked over, even though there was no interaction up until this point, where he looks over at me and he was like, I love you, man. And he was so like joyous and eccentric. I was like, I love you too. And I kept walking. And it wasn't until he got out of sight that rush of the memory on Bourbon Street, the exact way that he was dressed, it was the same man. The point that I'm making is the Elohim walk among us. Back to the story. The premise is it's the ultimate battle of good and evil. The witness in the stars is kind of paying homage to as above, so below. We should see elements of heavenly things here on earth, but unfortunately the other side as well. And it's their job to lead us astray. And the wages of sin is death. And so the whole story is about them trying to antagonize this character and trick him into it, and him coming through clean. But there's another version that I wanted to make. A good and a bad version. And in the second one, he makes all the wrong decisions. He gives in to temptation. Does what he wants to do. And the character that is Azazel kind of turns into the false prophet. And I realize in this line of thinking about what the structure of that story looks like, that the devils of this earth, it's not really, you know, you don't have to be the Antichrist. It is their job to just get you to be an Antichrist. But while I was thinking about all that, you know, I don't seem like it. I have kind of cleaned a lot of this up because I have a mostly Christian audience here. But when I'm alone and I think about the way that I've been mistreated by those of you that are in the know, and I'm not talking about you specifically, Dad. I'm like the royal you. Your whatever you people are, the ones who have access to this information, sworn to seek the whole thing, all of you. When I think about all the different ways that I've been mistreated, lied to, deceived. Deception is worse than lying. You know, I hate a liar, but a deceiver. It makes me so angry. And I realize that there's going to be someone similar to me. Not me. It's not going to, you know, one of my kind, as I say, that is going to take the bait. And he's going to do what he wants to do. And maybe this is a big claim, but I believe that he's going to rise in power and have influence from very, very powerful beings. And then he's going to be given power by a dragon. I don't think he'll know it, because the dragon is in the... And the number of your kind that he wipes off the map is going to overshadow the slaughter of the Christians so much that it's almost going to go unnoticed. Based on the way that you treat him, if you people, and I do mean you people, treat him anything, remotely, the way that you have done to me, and someone like that rises to power, You're in the same boat as us, dog. I meant to mention in the beginning of the video, I really appreciate, and now I'm not talking to the rest of you, I'm just talking to my dad, but I do really appreciate you offering to help me, the cinematography thing. You know, I have thought about that a lot. Not that, I mean, before you spoke to me, it's more of my refusal to speak to you, I get it, but I was like, man, it'd be so good. You know, I really enjoy making film. I've written skits. They're funny. And made some productions. And I was like, man, it would be so great to have support. But the trouble is, I don't trust you. And so we're going to have this conversation. Or our relationship will remain the same unto the grave and beyond. There is so much that I haven't revealed. So many experiences with so many people that some of it was absolutely demonic and some of it was impossible. So let's talk about my sanity for a minute, because I've made some pretty outrageous claims. I work a 40-hour job in which they depend on me. I've written, they're not really that complicated, but funny comedy skits. In comedy, you do have to reach the audience, right? You have to understand human psychology and all that. How to make something funny. Written two skits, produced one. That city councilman's wife actually acted in it. One of my friends doing me a favor. And I'm not name dropping, I'm just saying I'm a pretty logical dude. All the stuff that I've talked about in this video, I've kept to myself and on the internet for years, because I want to be fun to be around. Like, I don't, it's the drag if you're just like, what are the demons doing? My point is, since 2016, when all that stuff happened, my world changed. And then the world changed and started behaving differently towards me. Using trickery or deception and getting pissed off whenever it didn't work. Y'all aren't as clever as you think you are. Or invisible. And I really don't care whether it be Christian or anyone else. You know, I get with some people to slander you and say you're crazy, that like they're working for the other side and control the opposition, right? But I don't really care if like the Christians or any people that know me, that like personally know me, I don't care if they believe me or not, because you and I know what happened at least that day in the trailer. And the people that I was hanging around, Brandon Michael Williams was supposed to be my friend, and I know that he was working for something. I woke up in the middle of the night one night. I was staying in his guest room, and it was just a cat outside of his window going rawr, rawr. And he just kept saying, I'm trying, and he sounded scared. I don't know what it is you people go, again, highly suspect, hello, my name is human. The lyrics to it, it kind of spells it out, but I don't know what it is y'all people go through. But I'm sick of being mistreated, and I'm telling you that you're going to hurt someone so bad that they're gonna hurt a lot of people, good and bad people. Anyway, I can go on and on and on about all this. I don't care if it made sense to anybody else. You and I know. So, if you want, you know, and here's one last thing. like I said, I've seen there. I don't know for a fact that people are sworn to secrecy, but when you people reveal things, you get really nervous or scared or angry. It's like, and so I think it's against the rules. But again, Dad, here's the deal: either we're gonna have this conversation, or things will remain the same forever. And I get that. I don't know if you're given orders or what, but it's like, it seems to be they tell you to do something and you do it. But you could always ask. Who would believe me? Especially in like the Christianized church world. Who would believe me? And of the people that believe me, who would understand? There was a guy at my work when I first started working there. And I knew he didn't know me well enough yet. And I was walking through. And he goes, "You better be ready." And I knew what he meant. Not exactly. How do you prepare yourself for what's coming? But I knew he didn't know me well enough to say. He wasn't talking about the work we were doing. We were on break. And we didn't have anything big coming up. Again, that secret knowledge. I don't know what I am. I think some of you do. Whatever's coming, I don't know how to prepare myself for it. And I'm not even mad at the human, well, agitated, but not like angry, hateful towards the human element. Because again, you act as slaves. So why not go after the source? So this part's gonna suck, and it'll probably be the death of me. But should Yahuwah Elohim, and by his word alone, decide that I should battle, fight, make war against any power, principality, ruler, throne, spiritual wickedness in any place, Nephilim, or the spirit thereof, any fallen watcher class angel, or any fallen angel for that matter, the entire synagogue of Satan, and yes, I know how big it is, or that old fallen cherub himself, I will answer the call more than once, Lord willing, with fear and trembling. Every time, I'm sure of it. All these little hobbies that I have are just distractions, because I don't know what else to do. But just remember, it's not me you're fighting against. I'm just a vessel, and a filthy, tarnished one at that. See you around. Into